Good evening. I'll try to make this one short, and my wish is that it will be the last you will all have to hear about this Bigfoot photo thing. Now, alleged researcher Melissa Hovey took great offense to my last video and decided to write a lengthy blog on her search for Bigfoot site. In regards to me, she wrote that I, quote, uploaded a video to YouTube, and every bit of factual information he discussed in the first 42 seconds I actually looked at the counter was wrong. Let me add, information this bearded man could have found by a simple Google search of my name. So at 42 seconds, I stopped watching, but had a good laugh for 42 seconds. Well, since Melissa is known for her honesty, let's take a look at the first 42 seconds of my video in question and see where it's wrong. Good evening. In the wide and wild, wonderful world of Bigfoot drama, we have the most recent installment of skullduggery from those deep within the Squatchy community. This little slice of still life has hit the net like a ton of bricks, followed by a rampaging crowd of onlookers pushing and shoving their way into the maelstrom for a look-see. Before long, teams formed on opposite ends of the playing field, ready to hit the line of scrimmage. The football in question was provided by Ms. Melissa Hovey, heiress to the vast American Bigfoot Society empire, and author. Oh, I can really see her point here. I know she watched my video, so when she sees this one, maybe she could be kind enough to let everyone know just what part of that is wrong. Now, could it be that Melissa can't recognize commentary or sarcasm? I wonder if she could be so inept at reading people that she actually believed I thought she was a real heiress. Oh no, no one could be that stupid. Could they? I don't get a real image of honesty from Melissa. Some of the things she says just don't add up. For example, I sent her several private messages on her channel in which I asked some questions of her, a little about the answers in a moment. The thing is that out of one side of her mouth, she prides herself on keeping the identity, in fact, any information about her witness away from the public, regardless of how trivial it is. And out of the other side of her mouth, she takes the things I send her in confidence and in private and posts them on her public forum. Several of the questions I asked her are, do you own the photograph? If so, how did you obtain the copyright? If you do not own the photograph, then why did you claim copyright on it? Now, she did not give me a reply in a PM, but instead made a statement on her blog that all of the information I had requested was available on her blog since day one. Well, that simply isn't true. All she has ever said was that the photo was sent to her. She never made any mention that she was given the right of ownership to the photo. She still won't answer that question. It's not on her blog. What I did find on her blog was this about posting the photo. Quote, the witness wanted me to wait until spring. He was even refusing background information about the photo he sent me. Sometimes we just have to listen to what our gut tells us. Unquote. And then she posts it anyway. Now, she claims to have taken the high road in that the concern of her witness was of the utmost importance to her, yet not only did she post this guy's photo without his permission, but did so deliberately against his request. Melissa basically flipped her witness off and posted it anyway. Good looking out for the guy, Melissa. Then she claims copyright on the property, also without his permission. So now she's a thief claiming property that isn't hers. That's right, Melissa. I'm calling you a thief in public. Maybe you should file a defamation lawsuit against me. And then finally, when someone like me comes along and starts asking the hard questions, She refuses to answer, misdirects me to non-existent blog entries, and then posts my private messages on her blog. She's a real sweetheart. Since she has some experts investigating the photo, maybe she could ask them some pertinent questions about it and get back to me. One, since you stated in your blog that the witness used multiple 35mm cameras, how many were used? Two, how were the cameras set up? On tripods or in some other way? Three, since you reported that the zoom lens was used to take the photo, how far from the subject was the camera? Four, also, since a zoom lens was used, why was it necessary to crop the photograph? Was there too much of the subject in the frame? 5. Also, since a zoom lens was used and the camera was at a sizable distance from the subject, then why was the flash so bright as if taken at close range? 6. If slave flash units were used, then how many were involved? 7. Since 35mm cameras have a mechanical shutter release, how was the shutter release rigged to take a photo of a passing animal? 8. How was the amount of equipment necessary to pull this off, namely cameras, tripods, trip cables, slave flash units, and flash unit extension cables, kept out of the way and apparently invisible to the subject? If your experts haven't asked you these questions yet, then they should have. I say that Melissa was had, pwned, punked, and is simply too stupid to realize it. Prove me wrong, Melissa. Either present the authentic digital photo with the EXIF data file intact or show the 35mm negative. My bet is that this witness of yours is either playing you for an easy sucker or he's an invention of your own making. I'm out of here.